Well, good morning. Happy Monday to you. So as we seem to do every Monday, we begin our conversation talking about federal issues, federal actions that affect our community. Up until now, the conversation really has been about what we do in Montgomery County. And in that regard, I did bring our police chief and our chief counsel and our police chief, our corrections department head, and our general counsel to Annapolis on Friday to brief our delegation on how we do our business in Montgomery County. And in the president's vernacular, we do take care of the bad guys in Montgomery County. We do make sure that we cooperate with the federal government when it comes to people that have abused our hospitality and the privilege of being in this country. So I feel like the way we do our business, again, is appropriate, proper, and holds our community together and ensures public safety. And I think our delegation understands that. Now the conversation is a different conversation. It isn't really about what we are doing in Montgomery County. It is really about what the federal government is doing throughout the country. We have control over the things we do. We don't have control over the things that the federal government does. And we saw this past weekend raids that took place throughout the country that now have created a great deal of anxiety in our community and communities like ours throughout the country. When the executive orders first came out, many of us focused on the executive order with respect to the sanctuary cities. Actually, that wasn't the most significant executive order. It was the language in the I will build a wall order that spoke of how they are expanding the priorities of people that are subject to deportation to include virtually anybody who is in this country undocumented. That is very different and has far different consequences for our residents. Now, instead of talking about people who have committed violent acts, we are talking about people who literally are here and have been here for 20 years, who have given birth to U.S. citizens, and who now are fearful that they will be caught up in a raid and deported with no notice whatsoever. So that, in and of itself, generates different kinds of conversations internally and externally. How does Montgomery County respond to those different circumstances? So there are a couple things I'd like to share. One is we all need to be careful with respect to social media. We experienced rumors that there were raids taking place in Wheaton that were unfounded, that consumed our police and our community and just created a fair degree of panic. We need to be careful. We do not need to make people more anxious than they already are for understandable reasons. Secondly, we're now talking about what do we do for our residents when families are affected. So I've been in constant communication with the county executive over the weekend with the majority of my colleagues while we try and get our minds around how do we respond in this new environment? I note that ICE said that their raids were, quote, routine. The problem with that description is that nothing feels routine anymore. So our county will be exploring how it responds if there are, in some point in the future, raids in our county that end up tearing families apart and how we can respond to that situation compassionately and appropriately. Those conversations obviously are just begun and they will continue this week. We met on Wednesday last week when we had that press conference privately with the providers of legal services to immigrants. And they said to us in no uncertain terms that that was a major issue. And it's an issue that every large community in the country is grappling with, is to what do you do for people that are detained and subject to deportation? Do they have any legal representation? Do they know their rights? And so that conversation is also taking place as to what the appropriate role is of the county, and we don't have an answer to it, quite frankly, as to what the appropriate role is of the county in responding to that dynamic. We are in conversations and understand that private foundations are looking into this region-wide as to the possibility of providing a vehicle by which you and I and others could contribute to making sure that people who are subject to deportation understand their rights and understand their defenses. And there are some limited defenses available. And knowing those is important. So we're trying to figure out in this very new world order how we in the county can go about doing what is appropriate to assure our community that we're not going to turn our backs if there are raids in our county, which we certainly hope will not be the case, but we have no way to assure anybody that that won't be the case. But we don't want to create needless anxiety either. How do you do this work? You know, it's hard. The other piece, and I think Kenny Reichert is here from Senator Cardin's office. He's hiding over there. I've had conversations with the senator's office with respect to if there is a raid, how do we confirm that there's a raid? How do we know that there's a raid? How do we know what the goal is with respect to the raid? And ICE is a federal agency. And so I've turned to our senior senator and asked if they would be able to assist us should there be rumors of a raid, that we could seek confirmation as to the scope of that raid through their good offices, either through the police chief or myself or someone similarly situated or the county executive, so that we can put an end to rumors that, again, are so damaging to our community. And I believe the senator's office has agreed that that's appropriate. We didn't want our police chief, who spent all Friday night tracing down these rumors, spending his time that way, and we're a county, and they're not as accountable to us as they are to the senior senator of the state of Maryland. So I feel like we are doing the things that we ought to do. I don't have definitive answers to you. What I do know is that we are getting our minds around these issues to how best we can respond in a manner that is proper and measured, responsible, and compassionate. And those are our goals with respect to that. Let me turn to the work of the County Council. How about that? So we've got the Bethesda Plan, and beginning to make progress there. We took up the education-related issues in our last session, and those issues continue to be important. We've had community members who have expressed great concerns that the numbers that the school system projects are not accurate, and so we are facilitating further conversation between our community and the school system to ensure that we can say with confidence that these are the projections and therefore the plans that we have in place to meet those projections are reasonable ones. But if you don't have confidence in the numbers, it's impossible to get there. And it's just so terribly important that our residents have confidence, particularly at this moment in time in our national conversations, that people do not seem to have much confidence in government, period. We have today, we will be releasing our food insecurity plan, a food secure Montgomery County. Ladies and gentlemen, we have 78,000 people in Montgomery County who are food insecure. And as President John Kennedy once said, the war against hunger is truly mankind's war of liberation. people going hungry in Montgomery County is not okay. And so I was proud to have sponsored the legislation to require a five-year plan, and that five-year plan has been produced, and it's a good plan. People have done good work, and so proud of the work that's in there. We know we can do more, and we know we will do more. Let me... turn to tomorrow and full council. We will be taking up our spending affordability guidelines, and it's the first clear indication that our council has no appetite to go above the charter limit. The numbers in this reflect basically the inflation, if you will, of 2%, and those are the numbers I am quite confident we will be dealing with. You may have seen reports with respect to the region trying to get its mind around the other impact of a Trump administration as to what it will mean for local governments and our economies. Our county, like every other jurisdiction in the region, has been too dependent on the federal government for years. It's part of the reason why we are seeking so hard to diversify our economy and grow our private sector economy. But the impact of the Trump administration and cutbacks and budget cuts and workforce cuts will have an effect on our county. So it's another reason why we will undoubtedly be more prudent in our budgeting than we otherwise might have been, because the future is so uncertain on such an important matter. We have, in context of relying more on our private sector, we will be adopting our White Oak plan finally in effect. This is a part of our county that has not fared as well as it should have for many, many years, where we have not had the investment. And my goodness, if you can't take advantage of FDA and Adventist and the work that is going to continue to be important there and create a good, healthy economy around that, both in terms of jobs and commercial space. People talk about hotels, conference centers, talk about lots of opportunities there, and we have partners who are working hard with respect to it. Now, we've changed the relationship with our, quote, partners, so that now they do their work, we do our work. We incentivize them to do good work in terms of doing work sooner than they might otherwise do. And that's important, and we're taking on the infrastructure responsibilities that are ours to take on, and that's what we will be acting on. But we are now creating a context in which White Oak can, in fact, go forward, and that's important for our county. We also have a resolution to urge the state to ban fracking. I was proud to be the person on the council to effectively ban fracking in our county. But there is the desire, obviously, most of the work with respect to natural gas fracking would be in Western Maryland, and there is a desire by my colleagues and others to lay down the marker that fracking is not okay in Maryland. So I suspect that will pass overwhelmingly as well. Let me see, what else do we have? Just on minimum wage, I was in Annapolis last week testifying against the Davis bill, which would preempt local governments from addressing minimum wage, as well as other benefits like sick and safe leave. While we may differ internally as to the right path to get to $15 an hour, we are unanimous in believing that that is our responsibility, not something that the state should assume for itself. The state has great diversity, and our situation is not the same as Garrett County. Our situation is not the same as St. Mary's County. And we are in the best position to address the needs of our people. And I'm confident we will do so. We don't need the state to preempt us. How about if I stop? Open it up to you guys.
A couple questions about the immigration.
Yes, sir.
First of all, was the county ever able to trace back to the source of the wheat? Mm. rate?
I can't respond to that, so I don't know. I don't know.
Did anyone, was that something the police was undertaking, or is anyone,
As to who started the rumor, no, the police is not. The police, no one could confirm it.
Secondly, are you in touch with CASA, or is CASA on your calendar to discuss what Gustavo Torres floated last week, which is a law, kind of like the Trust Act that's pending in Annapolis, that would codify police, what police can and cannot do in terms of investigating crimes and asking about immigration status and what corrections officials can and cannot do? Gustavo Torres said that he was going to be talking to you guys about that.
He has not reached out to my office at this point in time, and all I can tell you is I think we are very comfortable in what we are doing. And so it isn't clear to me that we need to do more than our practice, which we are proud of and believe protects public safety and assures our community that we are not acting as federal immigration officials. That's not our responsibility. It's not something that we undertake. But I feel like we have struck the right balance.
Is part of this conversation you're having in the wake of this weekend, and I know this is kind of tricky business, but is there anything that the county can do proactively to help communities prepare for the possibility of these raids? I guess I don't want to use the word tipping off, but is there anything that you can do that at the front end? I know you're talking about legal defense funds, legal advice, but is there anything at the front end that you do to keep part of the immigrant population from falling into these dragnets?
Well, I think a Know Your Rights campaign is something that people are talking about and people are doing. So we are not going to get advance notice with respect to any action taken by ICE. Our federal officials don't get advance notice. They operate onto themselves in that way. But it does raise the question of, how can you prepare yourself? So when we met, for example, with immigration rights attorneys, we have some wonderful organizations in Montgomery County and other places. Catholic Charities is doing great work. The Capital Area immigration rights people are doing great work. These are people that are lawyers that are focused on how can we help these people. So one of them raised the issue of, have you established a power of attorney? Have you signed a power of attorney so that if mom or dad are taken away, what happens to our children? Because you could imagine a situation where mom or dad get taken away and suddenly you have your children being put in foster care. So how do you get ahead of that? How can you think about things that you don't want to be thinking about, but things that you may need to be thinking about in order to protect your loved ones? And so those are the kinds of things that our county's trying to be helpful with respect to and trying to make sure that in those kinds of situations that we are providing what we can provide. But this is also working with our nonprofit leaders. I mean, the foundations really are, I think, poised to step up in this regard region-wide. And so we want to create a situation where whatever the county feels is right for the county to do, it is working with our nonprofit community. It is asking individuals, here's where you could contribute. That if you want to help ensure that people have legal representation, then here's a way in which you can contribute. Because we haven't decided by any stretch of the imagination we're going to create a legal defense fund. Other communities have done that, but we haven't made that decision. We've got nonprofits that are doing good work in that regard. So the question is, what's the most appropriate way for us to act in this world? And so,
I'd say right now the Latino community, immigrant community, has a lot of fear. And in my radio show past Friday, a lot of people were calling. They're afraid to get the free lunch for their kids. They're afraid of using, the government assistance. And so my question to you is, eventually they don't even want to go out, to the grocery store just to do the basic things. Eventually they might be part of these 78,000 people in hunger, right? But how are you guys are planning to work towards building that trust with the community and the government, even though you have done good for the past years, but as of right now, it seems like it's getting bad.
Well, I think it is getting bad, and it's getting bad in ways in which are beyond our ability to control. We're doing everything we know how to assure our community that they are as safe as we can make them be. But there is that reality that the federal government is not beholden to Montgomery County. And so we're in a different world, and people, it's understandable how people can be fearful. I do think it is important that they understand that they should go about their lives the best they can, and they should not keep their kids from school. They should not take advantage of their benefits. I'm in conversation with our school system to ask them to be monitoring attendance and to see what the impact is in that regard. We will be meeting with our executive branch departments later this week, as we did a couple weeks ago, to see that they are monitoring what is happening in their worlds, what happens in HHS, what happens in our food delivery system. We're going to be talking with MANA and all of our food delivery providers to make sure that we understand what the demands are for them. So all I can tell you is our county, I think the county executive and my colleagues and I are united in wanting to act, again, compassionately, responsibly, recognizing the limits of our authority. So I don't know if I've answered your question, but.
Last week at the event in Silver Spring with the county executive, you said you didn't believe that Montgomery County counted as a sanctuary city under the executive order on immigration. What made you come to that conclusion, given that immigration attorneys I spoke with say there's no universal definition of a sanctuary city?
So I was taking the executive order at its face value, which says willfully withholding information is the definition. Okay? Now, at the same time, the executive order gives great discretion to the head of Homeland Security to come up with a definition, all right? But as I read the executive order, the essence of what they consider to be a sanctuary city is a community that willfully withholds information from federal officials. We do not do that, okay? When federal officials ask us as to when someone is going to be released, we provide that information as we would to you or anybody else. And it is public information anyway. It is public information because if somebody is being released from our detention center, there are communities that need to know that somebody who might have caused a problem in their community. That's true for immigrants and across the board. Is the point that anybody released from our detention center, it is public information as to the fact that they are being released and when they're being released. So there are things we do not do, okay? We do not ask people their immigration status, but we do not withhold information. We send fingerprints to the state. And we need to send fingerprints to the state. We don't know if somebody that we have just picked up for XYZ is wanted for murder in California. That's why you have fingerprint state databases. So we provide the information, and if the federal government asks with respect to people, we tell them. We don't detain people. We don't detain people beyond the time that they are held appropriately in our detention center unless there is a warrant for their arrest or probable cause. If there's a warrant, we hold them. And if there's probable cause, we hold them.
Did you reach out to the county attorney, the police chief, what it means to be a sanctuary city? Did you reach out to DHS to help them clarify what this executive order means for the county?
I think I've shared with you the composite view of our county. We were briefed by our county attorney with respect to the order. I would say to you that most people believe that executive order almost has no effect in and of itself. Okay?
I have a question with regard to a different aspect of the federal government. On Friday, as you may have heard, the Federal Transit Administration said that they will begin withholding transportation funding from D.C., Maryland, and Virginia because they have not yet created a state-level safety oversight agency. Also, in Maryland General Assembly, the legislators said there's a possibility that if they have to make an amendment, this whole thing will be delayed an entire year. What impacts could that have on at least Montgomery County?
Well, my hope and expectation is that the three jurisdictions will, in fact, pass the Safety Commission. It was a little unrealistic for the particular deadline that the Federal Transit Administration set insofar as we have a two-month, three-month window. D.C. clearly is going to pass this, and Virginia has passed it, and Maryland will pass it. So this is a timing issue. Okay, and they're putting down their marker and saying, this is serious. You guys need to assume your responsibility, and we do need to assume our responsibility. But this was always going to be a bit of a timing issue, and I had hoped that they'd give a little slack, given that our legislative bodies don't come in until January. So it's a little unrealistic to have expected them to have passed it by now.
But they're still going to be withholding money. Like, could that, what do you foresee any problems with that?
I am going to assume that it is a very temporary withholding.
Hey, Roger.
Yes, sir.
On Wednesday, DOC Director Rob Green was talking about a possible change in how ICE handles detainers to the county jail system. And he was saying right now they receive it based on criminal convictions. They give information based on people that have been convicted. They might change it to people who have only been charged. And he said he's not sure about how that policy is changing, but he's heard that that could be a change at the Department of Corrections. Have you heard anything about this, about how DOC receives detainers and whether people that are just charged are now going to receive detainers?
I know no more than I promise you Mr. Green knows, okay? And he is superb. So I would suggest you direct your question to him in that regard. Again, we do not detain people unless there is probable cause. We will tell ICE, this is when this person's leaving, and it's up to you at that point. That's their responsibility, not ours.
Is that something you plan on discussing with police and corrections on Tuesday when you guys meet with them about the hate incidents? Is this also going to include some of these immigration issues?
I would imagine that when you have the police chief before you and talking about issues, yes, I would assume that some of my colleagues will raise this. Yes, sir.
Macedonia Baptist Church. I'm wondering, what did the county know about those supposed graves under the HOC building? When did they know them? Is there anything that the county can do to resolve the situation?
So it's my understanding that actually the county was the one that in the first instance raised its hand, or our planners were the ones that raised their hands and said, there could be something here. So this is a part of our history that is not a good part. And particularly as we're about to commemorate Black History Month, it makes it all the more poignant. So what I know is that I have written our planners a strong letter saying that you need to be sure that there aren't ancestral remains on this site. And I've been assured that they will not approve any plans until they understand exactly what is there or what isn't there, and if there are, in fact, ancestral remains on the site, then that will dictate what they do. So I think that there was concern that the planning board was moving forward with approving a, quote, sketch plan without knowing what is there. And so I wanted to be sure that the approval of the sketch plan, if in fact that's what happens, does not in any way prejudice what happens if, in fact, there are ancestral remains found there. So they are in the process of negotiating with experts that do this work. And my understanding is that work will, in fact, be done, that they take that responsibility seriously. And if, in fact, they find remains, that that will determine how they go forward.
Well, I was supposed to say, as a follow-up, that as discussions about the graveyard under the HOC parking lot progresses, people have said that there are other, that they know of other forgotten cemeteries that have just been ignored for the past several decades. Does the county have a responsibility to make sure that those remains are reinterred somewhere where they can be properly dignified, or is this just something that's from a bygone era?
Well, it's a part of our history, again, that we have not, in the past, there is no written history of these things, okay? And because of the way in which we treated this community for so many years. And so you don't find it on historic registers. You don't find it as cemeteries. And so it just creates this conundrum, okay? In the legal world, it doesn't exist. So now what do we do? And I know that the planners are trying to get their minds around it, but this is not something you deal with every day, okay? And it's now coming to the fore, and we know that there's another example of it. So we're trying to get our minds around it.
Mm-hmm. Roger, you describe what's going to happen, likely to happen going forward. But with regard to this HOC site, is there any intention or any plan to? It is part of history, but it's not ancient history. Okay, it's 50 years ago, and there were accounts of remains being removed from the site. Is there any attempt or any possibility that the county's going to try and get some accountability here, hold players accountable for this? Even if they have passed, wouldn't this help the community get some closure on this, to have some accountability about what happened?
It's a fair question, but one that I haven't given enough thought to answer in a way that I'm comfortable with.
This is more just kind of a micro Bethesda Downtown Plan question, but I think you guys are going to be debating this soon. The parking lots along Wisconsin Avenue, the surface parking lots that border the town of Chevy Chase, I know you've probably heard from your constituents about this issue. Where are you at on it? Do you think those should be parks? Do you think it should be development? And do you think the county can make some money off them? Where are you weighing that issue?
So today I will be sending a letter to our director of Department of Transportation in which I ask him to evaluate what are the parking needs in Bethesda going forward. We have the Marriott deal, which takes certain parking spaces out of the public use, and we have this conversation on the other side of Wisconsin Avenue. So it seems to me that in a context in which you are anticipating X amount of growth, that you need to get your mind around how many parking spaces do we need. Then you look at these particular surface parking lots and you say to yourself, it is hard to get parks in downtown Bethesda. Where do you have the opportunity? And are you dependent on the private sector to do that? And if you're dependent on the private sector to do that, what's the time frame in which that will happen? We own these surface parking lots. So do I think they are a prime candidate for parks? I do. And it could be a contribution, if you will, that the county makes to this plan. Now, our Department of Transportation wants to be able to put some development on top of it in order to create underground parking. Well, that's one of the reasons why I want to get an assessment. How much parking do we need, and what are our options for meeting those parking needs? But there aren't many places where you can say to yourself, ah, I can create a park right there, and hopefully have it, the park then be accessible to Wisconsin Avenue. Okay, that what you want is this to be integrated. And you could imagine, if you will, that whereas people create a lot of vitality on the Wisconsin Avenue side, but if you had a lovely park, then you could start actually putting, if you will, restaurants and terraces on the backside because, oh my goodness, you're there looking at wonderful parkland. So this will be a serious conversation, and I am predisposed.
Mm-hmm. Roughly how many lots and how many parking spaces? I can only think of one surface lot.
There are four right behind the women's market.
Right.
And then it's going down.
Okay.
So those are what we're looking at. And I don't have the top of my head the number of spaces.
Thousands? Hundreds?
Many hundreds. Yes, sir.
Inspector General supposedly is looking into Dr. Pollard's spending at Montgomery College. I'm curious if you had a comment on that.
I do not. In the first instance, I consider that to be the Board of Directors, the Board of Trustees' responsibility.
Mm-hmm. Inspector General is yours, though, right?
Inspector General is ours. I don't dictate. None of us dictate what he takes on. Okay, that is not something that the county council has control over, or otherwise you wouldn't have much of an independent inspector general. So he does what he does. All right, gang.
One other thing.
Yes, sir.
It wasn't on the menu here, but have you gotten any fiscal impact statement on the fossil fuel?
I don't believe we have. And again, the bill has been amended to the point of which it basically says it goes as far as it can go without violating their fiduciary duty. And I guess what I struggle with is why there can be such administrative costs if in the face of having a purported ESG policy in which their managers are supposed to be looking at these sets of issues anyway. So what is the incremental cost of looking at these 200 companies and saying, can we get rid of this without harming our retirees? So I have found this to be a most unsatisfying conversation to date.
One other thing I wanted to ask about the Silver Spring Transit Center lawsuit. How do you think that's moving forward? It looks to be headed to a trial at this point, a 30-day trial, $4 million in expenses. Is this going to pay off for the county?
It better.
Yeah.
Let's be clear. We've been told from the get-go that we are confident in our claims.
What about that executive session last week? Can you talk about that?
I'd be so disappointed if you didn't ask that question.
It's been a week.
Oh, I forgot my answer then. That's right. It's only before.
Surely there's a statute of limitations on that.
If so, it is not run.
It's about recordation taxes and using recordation funds for differing projects. So.
Well, again, recognize that it was always true that there was a component of the recordation tax that was for county projects, county government. We are not taking a penny from that which we pledged for school construction. We are taking that which was built into it for our use, and it's being used for this purpose. All right, gang.
Small cell, you sent a letter to the small cell group?
We did.
What's the latest?
Need to hear from the county executive's people as to the consultants that they will be using for purposes of this, because that's going to guide us in any legislative work that we do. Mr. Reamer is leading our efforts to make sure, and we will be filing comments. I think we've already filed comments with the FCC saying, please don't preempt us. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you.